So, John, Barry from Evolution, welcome to the Sasha Classics group. Great honour for us to meet you properly in person, albeit we're all over the world. We've brought you together today just to hopefully ask some questions from the group, some questions, you know, you may find are pretty mundane, but I suppose to people like us that are banging to the music still and miss those days like yesterday, it's really great to hear your answers. So with no further ado, should we just crack on?
Yeah, cool.
Okay. Graham, you're up first.
Yeah. So I suppose, John, Barry, how did you both meet? And after your first mess, what kind of, I suppose, stoked the creative juices for you to create Evolution?
You want to start, John?
Well, to be honest, myself and Barry have known each other most of our lives. We're from like a small village in the north of England. We actually started off in marching band. So we know each other from that because Barry's dad used to be one of the kind of like teachers, and Barry will tell you some stories about his dad as well from a musical background. And then Barry moved away for some time, and then we obviously both kept doing music. And then Barry moved back here because his dad was an officer, so Barry moved back here. And that's when our paths crossed again, but more in a kind of like I was in like a new romantic band, and then I knew Barry could play and stuff like that. So we invited Barry down, and he could play "Jump" by Van Halen, which was very impressive. So,
I said
it's a banging tune.
Yeah. Have you got a Jack Daniels guitar, Barry?
No. We had something pretty similar to that later on in our Evolution early kind of deconstruction days, which it looked like a can opener, but yeah. Roland AX guitar.
Got it. Barry also had a Roland DS10?
No, D20 was the first kind of multi-tool thing I had. Yeah. But I had a JX3P as well, and I think you had an MS20, a 303, yeah, which we didn't know how to use.
That's right. We sold it.
And Juno 106 was it? It was your mates, wasn't it, that we bought?
A guy called Nicky Hansen, yeah.
Nicky Hansen, yeah, so...
All of which we've still got, apart from the 303, which is probably now about $2,500. But we bought it and then just went, what do we do with that? Because we was trying to make bass sound. So anyway, so that's, and it just kind of, it grew from there, to be honest.
Yeah. We both kind of, you know, even though I'd been moved away for quite a few years, we both kind of grown up very much being influenced by the same artists and the same music. So it was just a natural click when we got back that, you know, maybe we should try throwing some ideas together. I mean, we had no idea what we were doing. But at some point, something kind of clicked, and it just kind of developed from there. So it was originally John, myself, and Wes Allen. And Wes was at Preston Polytechnic. And, you know, we'd go up there and go to the Students' Union, and there used to be like a soul funk night. And we'd go out, and, you know, Wes introduced us to friends of his at the university that could sing, and one guy called Alan, who we first worked with, and we were just doing stuff, going up for a piss all weekend, and, you know, four lads crashing in Wes's little dorm bedsit, and we'd take up the keyboards, and we'd just piss around, trying ideas out, and eventually some stuff kind of sounded half decent. So we decided, you know, should we go to a studio and see if we can make a proper song? And we had no idea what we were doing.
But you had fun doing it.
I was like, ace, yeah, it was a really good laugh. You know, all of a sudden we felt like, wow, maybe we can do something. But yeah, it was pretty hit or miss at first. But it's funny, recently I found a load of DATs. And DATs normally perish the cassettes after about 10 years. And there's a bunch from the mid to late 90s that are just not having it. But then I found stuff from 87, 88, our very, very first demos, and I've actually managed to get them off them and digitize them.
Wow.
You know, this stuff never went out, and it was like, I sent it to John. I said, you can't believe what I've just bloody found. You know, there's a track with Denise Johnson, who, you know, passed away recently, which we did with her. And that was the first time.
That's actually pretty good.
Yeah, it was. I mean, for the time period, I mean, this was 87, 88. You know, and, you know, we were all loved up and going to Blackburn Rays and stuff. And so, you know, we were trying to do that whole, you know, freedom kind of spirit thing. And, yeah, it's mad. I don't know why we didn't put it out. And it's just crazy to think that we've still got it, you know. It's pretty...
I mean, would you like to see how somebody would remix one of those tracks today? Right?
We don't have any of the parts for any of that stuff. Jesus Christ, the gear on back then, we don't even own, you know what I mean? So,
yeah.
But, you know, considering we were starting out, it, and you listen to it now, it definitely wasn't shit. I mean, we learned a lot in the last couple of years, you know what I mean? Last two decades, I should say. But, yeah, I mean, it's kind of mad looking back at it, wasn't it, John? You know, and the track we did with Alan as well, which was called Solitude. And we were definitely into the Beloved at that time period as well. So you can hear that influence in what it was. But, yeah, we were just still trying to figure out who we were and what we were going to do, you know.
Well, that kind of leads on to the next question. So we've had some questions from the rest of the group, and one of the questions came in from Brett Smithson. He wanted to know, what year was your first gig? I'm assuming a live gig. And what was that experience like?
You can explain this, John, because I'll just give you the date.
I know it was a full hall in Southport. Bought a new pair of jeans for the actual gig. I think it, Barry, but did you say was it 80?
No, it was 1990. I think it was.
Yeah,
1990.
Something like that. It's just a bit of blur, to be honest. But yeah, it was something like that. We was totally live, going off that.
It was a W30. Do you know what I mean? Sorry. It took a shit.
It was totally live. it was at that gig where we had the. We'd met Sasha before, we'd been talking to him and all that kind of stuff, and we'd give him the tape of something that we've been working on. And then at the gig, you know, very typical Saturdays, he said, like, you don't mind if I just scratch over the back of this track like that, you can, because I've got a couple of ideas. Didn't tell us anything about it. And so he said, yeah, that's really cool, go for it. And then someone videoed it. I mean, obviously, we were dealing with all the other bits and bobs. We knew he was in the background getting scratching. But then someone videoed it, and it was only afterwards when we, and a lot of people said, bloody hell, that was pretty good. And we were like, well... And then it was afterwards that we heard what he'd done and was like, well, let's flipping ask him to see if he'll fucking like stick that on the track. We'll release it. And that was the beginning of the Sasha friendship.
Yeah. So we came down to the studio. We were at Spirit Studios in Manchester. And Two for Joy had just finished one of their tracks, and they were coming out from an all-nighter. And we were coming in, and of course, you know, Sasha's notorious for being late.
I had to go and drag him out of bed.
Yeah, he's
so consistent with it. His whole career has been like this. Like, have you? He turns up, he don't turn up, or he's late. The first time in the studio, I had to go around to fireman swearing salt and go and say, Sasha, are you coming? Yeah, man.
Yeah, so he showed up and he got out the sample that he scratched at the gig, and it was the Take Me Higher sample, of course. And then, you know, started working more on the arrangement and the structure of the track as well. And we ended up, I think we did a couple of times, didn't we, John? We did a couple at Spirit, and then we ended up going to, what was that? Was it, what was the other place in Manchester? Because we were working with Lee then, weren't we?
Yeah,
second version.
The one in Ancoats.
Yeah, and then the other one was with Lee Monteverdi, wasn't it? But it worked. Yeah. Where was it? What was the place called?
That was out in Altrincham, I think.
Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. So basically, the first, that's where the first gig led to, and that kind of like the next level, the next step. Because once me and Barry thought we knew what we was doing, and we did, But then once you've kind of like, you put a DJ in that, and then the relationship we had, because we was, you know, we was always around Sasha's house, and it was just that kind of melting pot of like, you know, not watching Coronation Street, let's mess around with this. And that's what it was, Baz, wasn't it? From there, we went from one level to another, and then just...
Yeah. That was Sasha's first introduction to any kind of production sound. Yeah. So, you know, it was definitely something that was going to happen. It was just we were the first people at the door kind of thing, you know. And, you know, when we actually put the release out, we did it on our own label, Positive Vinyl, which, of course, you know. And we had enough money that we'd made from a couple of gigs up in Scotland. And all we had was Scottish flipping pound notes. So we ended up, I think we got 1,000 records pressed up, didn't we, John? And
I won't digress any, but we also got contacted by the police. But we put £1,000 in our business account, which was pound notes. And the police contacted us and was like, what's going on here? And it was because a Scottish security corps van had been done over and sort of nicked a load of money before. It was a couple of scallies from the league. Explain it all. But that
brilliant.
So, guys, so you talked about the Positive Vinyl. I mean, that was your first label. I take it that first run. Did you make anything out of it? Was it
really out
there? I was thinking, right? At the time, I was working for Wigan Borough Council. We played Presto. We did. Barry, was it? It was Take Me High, not the public, wasn't it? But basically.
Take Me High, yeah. We got like 1,000 pressed up, didn't we? And then Sasha said, go and see John at Eastern Block. So we went into Eastern Block and it was a Saturday and we had a couple of boxes and we gave it to John Berry, and John says, how many have you got? And we said, well, we got 1,000. He says, well, can I have them all? I'm like, what do you mean all of them? We're supposed to be giving them to a couple of different shops. He says, I'll tell you what, I'll give you the money for them now and then go and get some more pressed up. And we're like, well, you haven't sold them there. He says, they'll be gone by Monday. So we ended up paying us right up front. So we went into the manufacturer who pressed them up for us and did a bunch more. And John says, but you got to give them back to me, though. So I think we ended up doing about 10,000 or something just through Eastern Block.
We got wise to it really, really quick. We realised that rather than selling to Eastern Block, we'd sell them for a fiver each. And we was going up and down the country. But like I say, I was working at Wigan Borough Council at the time, and my car used to disappear off the car park. Barry would like, he was working for me all the time, and we'd be off selling them. So we sold a hell of a lot of them for a fiver. That's what I'm saying.
the best one,
Sasha, they all covered the centre disc, so no one knew what it was. So.
Yeah, and the best one was we went down to London and, we went to Zoom Records.
Cowboy.
Trade, was it? We went to a bunch of different shops and, you know, got to know all the guys in all the kind of key record stores around the country. And we had good relationships with all of them. But it was really funny. We went down. What was it? What was it? Black Market? Was it? I can't remember. What was the one?
Yeah.
It was Black Market, wasn't it? Yeah. We walked in, and we said to the guy behind the counter, "says Yeah, we're Evolution. We've got a bunch of these records that that we've done with Sasha. You know, do you want any?" And the guy was kind of like, "No, not really. It's not really our scene. People wouldn't buy that in our store." And he's got a chart on and we're number one. And I'm like, "What you got on in it?" Says, we've just driven all the way down and you don't want anything. It's like, no. Anyway, I starts walking out the shop and about four guys who were in there buying records followed me out and said, hey, mister, can we have one of them records? So yes, we sold the whole lot outside the bloody front of the shop. And these dickheads in there, they didn't want it. that's the guy out of the band, you know. So we were two of us were there just flogging records to people outside the front of the shop. It's like, fucking idiots.
And did that, was that the case with all the positive releases that you were like walking around record shops?
Well, the thing is, you know, we were dumb enough that we didn't realise that there's this thing called distribution. We kind of did it on our own, you know, driving around the country. But the thing is, we got really good relationships with about 10 or 15 really key record stores around the country, Nottingham, Birmingham, everywhere. And, you know, they were right on our tails every time we were doing something, you know, we'd send them, you know, boxes of tunes and that, and they'd always pay up front because they knew they were going to go. And it was great for us because we had a cash flow. You know, we just had to keep making tunes, really, so...
We actually, I think, Bart, if you remember rightly, the guys from 808 State, that we was good friends with them, and they said, you've got to use it. We had a distributor in Stockton.
Oh, yeah.
A little bit moody, but it worked for a short time. So we kind of like went from doing it at the back of the car to our first step into doing distribution. Then we went with this guy, and then we just went with Amato, had been on the phone saying, listen, you've got to come here. So we went with Amato after that. And then that again, this is history with the releases.
Brilliant.
Cool.
Great.
Brilliant.
There's going to be a guy called Darren who was going to be here this evening, but he couldn't make it. So he, question from a guy called Brent. What's your musical background? Did you start with any instruments as children, etc.?
Yeah, well, like I said before, both me and Barry were in a marching band, so we learned music from there. I continued doing that up until I was 21, so... musicality, pressure and release, all that kind of like building atmosphere, expression. And Barry was doing, he was doing keyboards and stuff like that. So, yeah, so we've from the day one. Barry's dad used to be the roadie for the Beatles. That's all kind of really funny.
The late 50s to the early 60s when they went to Germany and stuff. My dad ended up going over to Germany with him, and 3 days later got deported for having a fight with the manager at the Star Club. My dad broke his jaw. Yeah, so anyway, best mates now. And Horst, he's Horst Fascher. He's the guy who basically gave the Beatles their kind of first break in Hamburg. And he's in his late 80s now, and him and my dad have been best mates since then, which is kind of mad, considering he got sent home.
Right.
He was like 20, 21, something like that. Yeah.
So, I mean, it's like, you know, it's always been music in both of our lives. Like, you know, we were some bands, that we always had a Hammond dog in the house, middle name's Hammond. That's not a good thing.
It was synthesizers though, wasn't it, John? I think that was it. Is that when electronic music first started coming up, and bands like Depeche Mode and Nitzareb and, you know, Human League and all that stuff, you know, neither of us could play guitar. So it was like, you know, when bands were kind of starting to become popular, and it wasn't just pop, it was kind of that new wave thing. It was so influential on both of us. Do you know what I mean? Being able to make records with these crazy machines. And, you know, John's MS-20 became the core of what we did as a band, because you could just do the weirdest flipping BBC workshop Doctor Who kind of sounds on it. We're like, oh yeah, that's an ace. It became a massive part of what we were doing, you know what I mean? But it was funny because we always had kind of two outs. We had a commercial side of what we were doing, and we also had a more underground and a darker side. And we were always kind of fighting with both of these kind of personalities of what we were as a band. And that's kind of when we did the cover-up EP, which was all Evolution. We didn't put the name of any artist on. We were trying to make the label look bigger than what it was. So we did four completely different tracks, trying to sound different. And of course, one of them was Love Thing. And it's the first kind of piano-y house thing we'd ever really done. And it was massive. It was just huge, you know, and Decon have been pursuing us for a couple of releases already. And, you know, Mike Pickering was like, you have to sign with a bigger label because you can only do so much on your own. Mm. And, you know, this is the record that's going to launch it. And they were right, you know.
Well, we actually, because it was, Barry explained it really well there then, we was trying to do different genres on one EP. So we had the kind of like underground vibe with Harmony, with the original Upsetter and the other ones. And then me and Barry went, shit, we need like a commercially tight record. So in the back bedroom, we knocked up things. I think it took us about an hour and a half, Baz, wasn't it?
It was long, really. I think what we were looking at was the vibe or the idea came from a Rolling Stones record, wasn't it?
Yeah, we just
I can't remember.
It's been Symphony for the Devil.
Yeah, it was that kind of vibe of the piano that we kind of initially had an idea for, and then once I kind of figured out that kind of movement, the rest of it just fell into place really quickly. And then we wrote the lyrics between John and I and Wes, basically at John's house. No idea how it was going to go. And then we knew Barrington Stewart, or Barry Stewart, and his brother Lawrence, who were big in Manchester, working with loads of different singers and stuff. And we called him and said, listen, we need a vocalist for this track. And he basically introduced us to Yvonne Shelton. And then they showed up late. I mean, as soon as she got in there, Yvonne had the vibe almost instantly. So, you know, we were working. Was it Mark Stagg we did that with? I think it was, wasn't it? Out of Blue Studios.
He will with K-Class, so he did Rivers, Rhythm is a Mystery, so it all kind of made sense.
Yeah. So he was the right kind of man for the job.
So, yeah, anyway, so I'll continue. Yvonne Shelton's, we got her, she's a brilliant singer. Her husband was in the keyboard player of Cynthia Red. So wow. It was all kind of like very, very musical at the time. Just that one little track again took us to that commercial side. It's kind of like got us signed to Decon. It was not something we had to think about, to be honest, because we didn't know if we wanted to be signed to a major. We was doing all right. But it was the right move to make from the career point of view. So the time that we had doing that, we got a lot from, because it put us in a completely different professional and commercial area, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Was the pressure on you to go more commercial once you signed to Decon? I mean, obviously, M People was massive, Pickering, signing.
Yeah,
obviously. But
totally. Sorry, Sam. Yeah, totally. They saw us as, you know, when you've got something like M People, you don't have, you know, the models there, so you don't have to do much. You just put another band in there. So kind of like, you know, we were supporting M People. We did stadium tours with them and everything like that. So it kind of like was like that, you know what I mean?
It'd be interesting to know what your relationship with Sasha's like now.
Well, it's two different relationships, you see, because Barry has a professional working relationship with Sasha. I don't have that relationship with Sasha. I would say I'm a lot more friendly with John. I mean, John are good mates. But I was out with them. I was out with them both last year at Manchester when they both played together. And it was just like old times. It was, you know, taking the piss out of each other. You know, and it's there's a genuine kind of like, you know, friendship there. It's not like, you know,
it's not forced.
No, yeah. So, you know, you can take the piss out of each other. We know where we've all been. We know where we started. So there's no egos or anything like that.
Cool.
And so, John, you mentioned earlier you started out marching bands, but kind of what's your, I suppose, instrument range, right? Have you learned quite a few over the years?
Drums and percussion, so anything that you can hit with a mallet or a drumstick. So he was, you know what, it sounds a bit naff, but it was 120 people. Everybody had to learn music. We were really good. We were the British champions. We were on telly with it and everything. So it's kind of like it's always done well for me, music, you know.
Yeah.
Both our parents, my dad was into kind of like that. And obviously, you know about Barry's dad now. So
yeah.
Both our parents were kind of like into the interview. So it's going to happen, isn't it?
You know, again, is that working?
Is it?
Yes.
There you go.
We're all
right. Sorry, we got to the question about. I was explaining that you know, with Sasha, obviously my relationship now is still like a mate. Yours is a bit more complex because you still have you've had a work relationship with the work you've been doing for the last 10 years. So.
Yeah. Well, with me, you know, because when Jon and I kind of split and went our separate ways, when we kind of had to fall fluid, when you know there was a lot of turmoil in the industry because of the piracy market and, you know, other things, distributors went down and all sorts. You know, we were just at a point where we just felt it was time that we needed to kind of move past this. So I ended up flying out to both Jon and I's good friends, Guy Oldhams, who was out in Los Angeles. And within a couple of weeks, I was kind of doing a few little projects with people in the States. And then Jimmy Van M called me up and said, "Oh yeah, you're in America." I was like, "Yeah." So, well, listen, Sasha's basically moving to the States. Him and Zoe are going to settle down and marry and stuff. So Sasha's going to base himself in the US. So he's curious if you want to get involved with some projects he's got coming up. And he hadn't done anything for a while. I think the last kind of production he'd done was the New Order remix. And he basically sent me the Uncle track in a state. Yeah, right. And said, "Do you want to come and work on it?" So I said, "Yeah." So he just got this house in Florida. So I flew out and was supposed to be there just for a couple of weeks to work on this remix. So I was there working alongside Gaetan Shura, who Jon and I had known for a long time anyway, and this other guy who was working with him called Simon Wright, who was basically Sasha's little secret weapon. And Simon basically got involved during Ed Von Dagger. He basically, Sasha was cataloging all his record collection at his place in Ansley Place. Where was it now? I can't remember where it is. Henley on Thames. He had a house out there where him and Zoe were living for a while. And basically, he put an ad out to get someone to be an intern to catalogue his record collection. So wow. Simon answered the ad and came to his house. And his studio was just a mess. There was shit everywhere and cable just all over the place. And Sasha was going away to do some shows, apparently. And Simon said, "You know, I do a bit of studio work." He says, "Your place looks like a bit of a mess. I mean, do you want to kind of take a look at it and try and figure it out?" So Sasha's like, "Yeah, okay." So Sasha goes away and comes back. And there's this massive pile of cables and stuff in the middle of his living room when he got back. And he's like, "What have you done? You know, what have you done to my studio?" And he walked in and the place was completely set up and perfect. And everything was working probably for the first time since he moved in there. And Sasha's like, how come you know all about this?" He says, "That's what I'm doing. I'm at university, basically doing music production." So, that's when Simon started kind of working with him. And then I met Simon basically when he came to the US because he brought his team that had been working with him on Air Drawn Dagger to the US. And I got involved and basically helped to co-remix and then did the mix down. Excuse me.
So we're live, folks.
Yeah. Calling back.
My wife was just shouting, "Big Mac's here, Alexander."
That'd be Sasha saying.
So, So, yeah, so basically I got involved in that and was supposed to be there for 6 weeks and left 18 months later after we finished the first involvement album. They kind of kidnapped me and wouldn't let me go. So, yeah, it was a bit of a surreal thing because he basically got this beautiful house on a beach in quite a secluded island off Casey Key, which is one of the keys, about an hour south of Tampa. And I spent more time at the house than anyone because everyone was coming and going. Zoe was studying in New York. The guys were going back and forth between the UK and the US. And most of the time I was there on my bloody own. So it's kind of weird living on a beach that with no one around, you know, with people coming in and out. Charlie May was coming in and out and I had to fly back to the England every couple of weeks and come back. So, yeah, it was a pretty mad couple of months.
I was going to say, so what body of work did you work on exactly with him when you were with there? You talked about
Inner State was the first thing. Then we did the Cirque Delay track. And then we were kind of sitting around and Sasha was like, you know, I've got to do a mix compilation. And what are we going to do? He says, we've got to do something else. We've got to do something groundbreaking. And we kind of all kind of threw around this idea. Well, let's do a mix album, but why don't we remix all the tracks and make them exclusive for the mix? So we spoke to Andy at Global Underground and said, listen, this is this idea we're coming up with. You know, it's going to need some funding because it's going to take us a while to do. And, you know, it has to be financially supported for me to do it. And it's going to be a lot of work. And Andy was totally on board right from the get-go. So Sasha was looking around for music and things that we could basically put on the album. And Zoe's a mad music head as well, his wife. And he gave us all Rick Schnauss's album, Strange Isolated Place. And, you know, the first track remix for the album was the last one, which was the old Rick Schnauss track. What was it, On My Own, I think it was called?
Yeah.
And you know, he totally wanted to make it really punky and really a lot of attitude to the record. So, you know, we kind of got this idea together and put it together because the whole thing's got a kind of punky attitude to it, but it was kind of sat back as well. So we just did, we basically gave it some balls, which is what it didn't have in the first place. But so much of what Ulrich had done himself anyway, and completely kind of made it like the Ramones or whatever. We just wanted to make it punky and a load of attitude. And then he started playing it out and it was just going off. And he's like, well, that's the end of the album. So we've got to go from there backwards. So we found the tracks in reverse for the album. And that's kind of how it all came about. And then I worked on everything with him up until 2011. So it was a long time period. Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
What's that process like? I mean, do you find yourselves, you know, both of you, I suppose, having set sort of roles within that process of creating music? Or is it, look, I've got a great idea, we're going to do this, or this drum pattern sounds fantastic?
The way it works with myself and Barry is you've got to have two heads. And it really depends who's doing what. But you can be firing creative ideas with this head, but then the actual putting in a production and making it sound brilliant and arranging it all is a different head. You know what I mean? I was absolutely fantastic at that.
I was always kind of the engineer side of things as well, even though I didn't know what I was doing. But that was the thing that I was really into. So I was definitely the one kind of shaping ideas as we were throwing things against the wall. You know, But it was weird. I mean, we used to sit and listen to so much music as well. And John was like, oh, have you checked this out? Check this bloody, you know, and that would be a catalyst for ideas as well, from just random things. And we'd be trying to figure out, have they done that? You know, why is that sound that way? And what instrument have they used to create that? And that's kind of how we kind of muck around. And, you know, one of us would come up with a line or a hook and it'd be like, yeah, that's where we're going to start. And it's the same with Sasha as well. You know, there's always four or five people involved in the project. Mm. And it could come from anyone. And then what we tend to do is we'd be in different rooms and we'd work on different tracks and then we'd swap them over. And the track you've been messing with, I'd mess with, and the track I'd been messing with, it would go in the other room. And, you know, things would always go back and forth like that. And I kind of work like that as well, you know. So it's like nothing's a bad idea.
No.
You know what I mean? And at some point, something's going to rise to the top and it's going to be, that's it. That's where the focus needs to be. And that's how the process would work. I mean, John and I, we were notorious for doing remixes in like 10 hours.
It was very quick.
Just, we'd get in the vibe and we'd have our head down and we'd just be at it. And we'd finish the main mix and we'd always have to do a main mix and a dub then. And we'd do the dub in about 3 hours. And they were always the best mixes because it was just, yeah, that's going to work. Just throw that at it, you know. And I'd always go off on a tangent with the dubs as well. We weren't really precious about what we were mixing at that point, you know. You know, yeah, you'd have to kind of stay loyal to what the original track is with the main mix, but the dub, we'd basically turn it on its head. And we'd always be a lot darker and a bit more minimal and just a bit more menacing. But you know, that's kind of where our progressive kind of heads kind of came from, you know. So there was always two sides to what we were doing, you know.
And I suppose just kind of to that point then, and so obviously look, you guys have explained how well you know Saturn, the different relationships that you have as individuals with them, right? For us, I think, you know, Evolution have tracks like Northern Exposure 1, Expeditions, Northern Exposure 2. Were you guys, did you have that conversation with him where he just wanted to come directly to you and you knew that you were going to have a track on it? And I suppose the follow-on would be, did you have any idea how massive that first album was going to be globally?
We knew we influenced them, didn't we, John? You know what I mean?
We never did anything scratch. So all them tracks that are on them albums because we've made them. And they were doing them albums. It's just like, we're looking for material.
They asked for stuff, didn't they, John? You know what I mean? Yeah. And
we were always going to get in there first, if you know what I mean, because we were, the music was what we were making. We weren't making music for them, but we were making music for them. For anybody, from a dance floor point of view, it's just that they were their mates, obviously. You know, they were getting for stabs. The compilations, we just got lucky. I mean, you know, it was just like, wow, we're on it. We never tried to get on them.
Okay.
It was just like, you know, we've got, you know, feel like that track, and I put it on this album. We're like, yeah. It's like, yeah, you know, these albums, remember, they become bigger as the years go on because the seminal albums, at the time, it was a compilation album. I'm not saying it's just a compilation album, but it's a compilation album, and we've been doing a lot of them kind of things at the time. It's just that, you know, they're our mates. It made more sense that we, you know, we give them the best stuff because that's what you do, isn't it?
It got to a point as well where it's like we'd have to have a toss-up, you know, are we giving this one to John or are we giving this one to Sasha? And it'd be this kind of... Because we couldn't just, you know... We couldn't just befriend one because we'd always get a lot of kickback from it. And, you know, because they'd always be playing together and it'd be like, where'd you get that from? So they'd end up having fights and they used to take the piss. I remember we'd done Firewire and it had this big arpeggiator break in the middle of the Juno. And it was really weird chords, wasn't it, John? It had nothing to do with the rest of the track. And we sent it to them, and they were playing Twilo, and they both went for a piss at like 7 a.m. in the morning. And they said, "Oh, we'll ring them up and we'll tell them it's shit, it's bombed." So we can hear the music in the background, and they're like, "Yeah, yeah, no, that break, it's horrible." I don't know what you did with the middle, but it just doesn't work. It's like, really, what's the dance floor? Winding us up. You know, it's like the whole thing's going off like crazy. And they could go and have a piss because it was 14 minutes long.
Guys, going back to the Northern Exposure and obviously Phoenix being a huge, huge track off that. But it didn't come out. You didn't release it on Fluid till what, 99? Was it? Why? What was the story behind that?
I don't know. I don't know before we called, to be honest. There is a story behind that, but we can't really go too much into it because me and Barry have actually forgotten who it was for.
It was a remix, wasn't it, John? We realised this is too good. This, you know, we got to stop whatever we're doing and we'll start another version for him. So yeah. We just kind of left it because we knew we had something special. But the weird thing was, is we were kind of a real turning point for us as a band, because Yvonne had split, we'd started working with a new girl, Lisa Millett, and we'd done a load of really, really good stuff with her. That was definitely more on the commercial tip because they were trying to mold us as another M People. And of course, we supported M People on a lot of their early tours. We did all the university tours with them. We did the arena tours in the UK. So we did Birmingham NEC, Wembley Arena, all that stuff. But we just couldn't get traction with Decon. And basically, we were always doing the club stuff as well, the more darker, progressive stuff, because we were very influenced by what John and Sash were kind of finding, you know. And then what kind of happened was, We were getting pissed off because we weren't getting recognised for what we were doing. So we decided we were going to put Phoenix out as a bootleg. And we said, we'll just do it, right, and trying to force their hand. But they didn't want to know. So we kind of sat on it, and it went on the Love and Exposure album, and that was it. And then we did Your Love is Calling, which was an epic monster prog thing. And we basically forced Deacon's hand. Because we had a couple of really good press stuff, charted everywhere. It was the top of the charts all over the place. And we made Deacon put it out. And they're like, yeah, but this is where we don't want you going musically. So, well, this is where we're going. So you're either with us or you're not. And at the same time, John and I were like, well, fuck this. Let's set up our own label and we'll put out what we want to do. But of course, because we were contractually tied to Deacon, we couldn't put anything out as Evolution. And then we found out that when Deacon finally released Your Love is Calling, it just barely missed the top 40. And then somehow our management got sent a bunch of vinyl, and the barcode on the back of the record was half of it was the Evolution release and the other half was M People. So M People were getting credited for sales of a record that wasn't theirs. And whether it was done deliberately or not, I don't know, but there was two different barcodes on the sleeves. So it was pretty controversial, you know what I mean? And it didn't go top 40. It just missed it by barely, you know? So we were like, well, fuck this. But we didn't put anything out as Evolution. So John will explain Andy when we met Andy Ling, because Andy Ling was a kid in the village who gave us a bedroom mixtape, didn't he, John?
Yeah.
And it was brilliant. His selection of music, his mixing. And he's 18, he's at university, you know what I mean? And we're like, do you want to be famous? And he's like, what do you mean? He says, well, we need to put records out and we can't put records out. But if you want to come in with us, we'll have a muck around and we'll see what come up. And we did Calling Angels, didn't we?
Yeah.
And Andy was an overnight sensation. He was basically, you know, a front for me and John to try out other things. And then, you know, Digital Bonds came along through our friend Kim, and we helped kind of mold and produce those guys. And then the label just kind of grew from there, that we'd be on the back burner helping these kids who've got really good ideas bring it to a finished standard. And of course, we'd get to put it out. And we did that with everything on the label, every single piece that was on there. Yeah. It was a good time because we were trying all kinds of stuff. And these kids basically were like we were 10 years earlier, great ideas, but no real know-how. But you knew there was something really special. You just needed to kind of clean it up and, you know,
identifying the potential in people and helping steer them, right?
You know, and the Digital Blondes, I mean, those guys, Jesus Christ, their hooks were massive. You know, okay, we nearly got sued by ABBA because they were a bad example.
They were massive because they didn't tell us that one of the main hooks was Abbott.
Yeah, it was Abbott. Get off an hour record. Hour record.
So we put the record out and got a cease and desist from Abbott's management, which is
MCPS told us to destroy all the vinyl, so we had to get rid of the vinyl. But we did all right, though. We kind of got caught out off there. Maybe mention that next time we're putting a record out.
Where are we now, question wise? Because we're doing some great stuff. Just flowing.
It's good stuff. Keep going.
Yeah, we've just jumped around, Simon, because the conversation has been flowing. So I'd say just pick one, wherever you want to go next.
Yeah, there is a big question, I think, guys, going back to actually, Andy, you do this one. Number eight. Yeah. It's important.
So there was never an original version of Metropolis released. And I don't know, and you must be aware that a few weeks ago, we did like a poll of the best Sasha remixes.
I did see that, yeah. I was quite surprised.
And Metropolis wiped the floor. And yeah, let's bear in mind, you guys were not really sort of present as such within the group at that stage. No one was sort of... no one was promoting that you were in the group and stuff. So it was a very natural... win, if you like.
That's one of those Twilight Zone kind of moments, isn't it, really? You know what I mean?
So
it was weird because John, Wes and I had done the track, and the first version was a similar kind of thing with the first track we released came out of nowhere, where Sasha came in and it didn't really change what we'd done that much, but basically added the vocals and stuff and just made the moment in the record the moment, you know. It was really the piano dub, which was Sasha's kind of different idea or approach to it. Because we were already playing it out, weren't we, gigging it, John, without the vocals or anything on, you know, the whole chord sequence at the beginning, you know, we already had that in the bag, you know. It's just, you know, I think Sasha basically just made it a little bit more compact and made the moments become real moments in the record.
If I remember rightly, we did it at Fawn in Sheffield. It was a really good session because it was going there. I think Sasha, and then and all of a sudden, like there's a reason for that. I need to go up in the morning. He used to book the midnight, the night ones because it was cheaper. And then obviously we had a little bit of rest, and then just like bingo, it came apart. I mean, he was messing around with the piano. For a while, we was getting nowhere at all, and it just happened. And then the arrangement was like thrown together in no time.
Right.
And again, that was one of the tracks that Barry, I'm not talking out of turn, Andy, I thought it was okay. We want to put it down as one of our best ones. But then, as these things happen, that's gone pretty well. Yeah, that seems to be doing well.
Yeah.
Got from Florida and people like that saying his biggest tune in Firestone and all that kind of stuff. And then we're just like, right, okay, then there's another one.
It was mad. I mean, the thing is, you've got to remember at that point, you know, there was such an energy within the club scene anyway. And, you know, the main mix was just, it was anthemic. You know what I mean? And I think records at that time period, I mean, you go back and you look at videos now of, say, like Quaddy Park in Liverpool.
Yeah.
And it's like there's a bar fight. You know what I mean? It's not. It's just this crazy amount of energy. And if you want the right record, you know, ours or like Enjoy or, you know,
Anthem.
And it'd just be, you know, and you look back at it and go, Jesus Christ, you know, it's like it was so mad. The energy that were in clubs at that point.
So, gotcha. That leads on to our next question, well, one of the next questions. You know, the clubs at the time, are certainly in the north, were rocking. I mean, what were your clubs like? What were the main clubs you guys went to if you weren't PA-ing, if you weren't, you know, and were you on the darks for all night like everyone else, or were you going
to bed? Dancing to our records at the time.
Yeah.
Well, it was weird because when we were getting started, we were mucking around, and you know, especially when the whole Blackburn thing started, we'd already started going to the Hacienda, and there was a hardcore kind of crew from our town and a couple of towns over, and there'd be about 35, 40 of us, and we'd all go out and we'd have a couple of booths that we'd always stay in the same booths in the Hacienda, and we were there every Friday and Saturday. So, you know, there was all these amazing records going out, you know, and it'd be like Mike Pickering and Graham Park on the Friday night. And it was just epic. And we kind of got to know people, you know what I mean, who were in and around the Manchester scene. And then, you know, when we started getting support from like the 808 State Boys on Sunset Radio, you know, it kind of really opened doors for us to kind of get involved with the community even in Manchester. So, you know, bands like A Certain Ratio, you know, 808 State.
Yeah, was good mates with Substump, became the Dose.
Of those guys. And it was weird because what kind of happened is Darren and Andy from 808 State said, listen, we've moved out of the place where we had our studio. There's this new place opened and they've got really good units, 24-hour access, pretty safe. It's in Ancoats. And it's
pretty safe.
Where home used to be. And 808 State were in there, a guy called Gerald, Nipper.
Who did Take Me to Infinity? No, Take Me to Infinity. Oh, no, it wasn't. No, who was it?
Oh, what they're called.
They used to have the big posh cars because they'd have loads of number ones.
Yeah, it was a bit...
What were they called?
A bit more cheap.
Kelly Loren sang with them.
Love Station? No, not Love Station. Love to Infinity?
No. Set Me Free.
Yeah. Oh, I've got that.
Rosella?
No, not Rosella. When I hold your breath.
Anyway, enough of that shit.
Yeah.
So, anyway, so we moved in there, and then there used to be a studio that Simon Crompton had next door to our place, and Black Grape did the Grape Tapes album in there. You know, Bez and Sean would be in there all the bloody time. So it was mad because there was all these different styles of Manchester music, and everyone was in the same building, and we'd all be borrowing gear off each other and, you know, can I borrow one of your mics or can I muck around on your Moog, you know, and stuff like that. And it was just, you know, everyone was kind of mucking in regardless of what you were doing. You were part of the whole Manchester thing. And it was an amazing time for us, you know, to kind of, you know, be associated with artists that, you know, especially 808 State, you know, they were cool as hell doing techno. And we were definitely a little bit more overground than kind of what they were, a bit more mainstream. But, yeah, you know, there was definitely a respect between anyone that was part of what was going on in Manchester because we knew how special it was, you know. And I think that, you know, we'd go at the Hacienda and, you know, we'd end up back at our place later on or whatever or at someone else's gaff, you know. And then, of course, with the whole Blackburn thing, you know, everyone would go to the Hacienda first and then, you know, you everyone would find out where we've got to go or where we've got to meet to figure out where the party's going to be and then go over to set ends and just wait for it all to kind of go off. And yeah, it was a mad time, you know what I mean? I remember when Suddy and John first played Hardcore Uproar, you know, and they'd recorded the sound at one of the raids earlier. That was at the beginning of the record. And, you know, that was a crazy moment. You know, it went off and... We knew they'd got the deal with FFRR, with Tongi, and, you know, they were one of kind of the first new kind of bands that were coming up that had got a deal. So we're like, wow, maybe there is a chance that we could get something here, you know.
Yeah. Barry, sorry about that. I couldn't concentrate on my OCD kitchen. It's Entrance.
Entrance, that's it, yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Sorry about that. I just remember they had, like, Ferraris and all sorts of I was over Ford Orion. And thinking, like, are we doing the right thing here? And then parking next to the Ferraris because they'd had the bubble. Sorry about that. Right, back in the room.
As a Simon,
he's black, there he is.
He's back.
Guys, so, keep going with the questions. We've got them on a roll now.
Yeah.
Like cheese and onion.
What's the next one?
Graham?
So, hardware and instruments were you using to write and remix your tracks back then? And how have things changed?
I had a D20, a Roland D20, which was the first kind of multi-timbral PCM-based, really shit sounds keyboard. And we knew we needed a sampler. So at the time, Roland had just released the W30, which was their kind of first entry into sampling. It had 14 seconds of mono, wasn't even stereo. So,
incidentally, I was the only one with Joe about to take a loan out to buy it.
Yeah. So we got that, and that was our sequencer as well. We used to write everything on that. So Love Thing, you know, was written on that keyboard, you know, the whole thing, the sequence and everything. It's a fucking nightmare. We kept ringing Dawson's Music in Warrington saying, we don't know how to use this, you know. It's terrible, you know. And yeah, I mean, that's kind of where we kind of started. And it wasn't until we got the deal with Decon that we ended up buying an Akai sampler and a couple of other bits and bobs. But the W30 became still a core part of what we were doing at that time as well. And I think Mark Bell from Shibuya Records, who's Black Cat, Mark got a deal early on as well. And that was the first time that we'd seen an Atari, wasn't it, John? An Atari STE 1040 and, you know, Cubase. And it's like, yeah, that's definitely the way to go. So we ended up getting an Atari with the Decon deal. And that was a real turning point for us from a kind of production point of view, because everybody was using them, you know.
And at that point, did you have jobs as well, or were you just doing full-time music production?
As I said earlier on, I was working in the stores at the Borough Council Street Lighting.
Yeah.
And I remember on the Sunday morning, sorry, the Monday morning, they used to run the charts. So I was handing out 200-watt light bulbs. And they were running down the charts, and they were like number 17 this week, Evolution.
Wow.
I handed me notice it because I made more money in a week than I made in a whole year there. And it was really funny because at the time, the guy, really nice guys, like, he said, like, the day I left, he said, "No, John, you know, we really look with your music career, with slight tongue in cheek. Hope everything goes well." 2 weeks later, me and Barry were clapping our hands over our ready for the 17 million people on top of the box. It's really weird. It went from nothing to that kind of thing, you know what I mean?
Well, it wasn't nothing. I mean, we had a fan base, didn't we? But we just,
The
Decon release, you know, everything that Mike Pickering said, you know, whatever you're doing, you know, we can do it tenfold. So you got to give us a chance. You know, there's only so far you can go on your own, and you know what you've done is amicable, but you know, you got to let us run with it. And you know, eventually we did, and it was mad because they picked us up. They signed Way Out West. They signed Sasha, Three Licks. You know, of course, Black Box was the big thing back then as well. So to be on a label associated with other artists like that, it, for us, was brilliant. You know, it was just such a great thing to be associated with all of them. You know.
So for probably the majority of us on this group, we're of an age that we remember the golden years of Top of the Pops. So what was that first show like, right? Because I'm really interested now to ask the question.
This could end up being pretty lengthy, this, couldn't it, John? The second time we were on when it caught fire.
Caught fire?
The best story about this pop is that you get picked up by a limo. We got took there. That was all very, very nice. And then after it, you get taken back by a limo. Me and Barry were sharing this limo. We're taking us back to the hotel. And then all of a sudden, like, there was like cars following us, and we're going, "This is it." And they were like girls and all these cars following, everything like that. And then we got back to the hotel. We jumped out of these limos, and like, you know, the other high. And all these girls, "It's not Take That."
On the wrong car.
Swiftly about turn and pissed off. Like, we was like, "All right, okay."
But anyway, what happened was, when we were doing the rehearsal, they basically do a rehearsal for the lighting, and then they do a rehearsal for the camera guys, and then they do the take. So it's a whole day thing. Anyway, we're on, and basically the way they were doing our shot, New Order were on doing Republic, and it was going to go straight from there on a pan shot to us. So it was all one take between them and us. There was no edit. So New Order do their bit, and it's great. Do a really good job, and the camera pans around to us guys, and we start doing our thing. And then I'm like, John's like, something's burning. I'm like, so I'm walking behind me, and there's a light behind me that's kind of shining up, and the gel on the front had touched the light bulb, and it had melted, and the light had caught fire. So John's like, it's going to burn that. So I end up, there's a guy to the right of me, camera guy, and I'm like, hey, mate, listen, the stage is on fire here. And he's like, what? And there's supposed to be video, and he's like, oh no, that's lighting. That you need a lighting guy. I said, it's on fire. He's like, oh, where my camera?
Not my problem.
So they end up shutting the whole studio down. The fire department show up, the whole bloody lot, and they say, listen, everyone go for lunch. We'll figure it out. We'll come back. So we all went to the pub. So we were with cast from EastEnders. There was New Order. There's loads of us all getting pissed. So by the time we come back, we were pretty well oiled by the time we were going to go through it and video it again. So yeah, it was a pretty brilliant. Bad night, wasn't it, John?
Yeah.